Thanks a lot, everyone. Thanks a lot, the organizers and everyone who's organizing this DevOps Day Poznan. I'm glad to be a part of this. And today we'll be talking about an aspect of DevOps called chaos engineering with Litmus Chaos 2.0, which brings in the evolution of obviously Kubernetes native as well as non-Kubernetes native chaos engineering. So a little bit about me. My name is Prithvi Raj. I work as a community manager for the Litmus Chaos project itself. It all started back at Maya Data back in 2020, but now I'm part of the Chaos Native, which helps, obviously one of the main sponsors of the Litmus Chaos project, helps provide support for the same. And I also work, I've worked as a co-organizer for KCD Bangalore, Kubernetes Chaos Engineering meetups. We organize every last Saturdays of the month, and Chaos Carnival, an event based on chaos engineering. You can try and connect with me on Twitter and LinkedIn. Here are my credentials and my handles. So starting off the agenda, we'll be talking about chaos engineering here. We'll be talking about Litmus Chaos. We'll be talking about the journey and the advantages. I'll try to cover the core components if time persists, but if not, it doesn't, then we'll be talking about the roadmap and how you can be contributing to the project itself. So starting off, before we move on to chaos engineering, what chaos is or what exactly brought in the idea or concept of chaos, let us understand what is resilience or what is resilience in the Kubernetes paradigm. So obviously resilience is nothing but if, let's say, our system is under attack, or if there's an outage that possibly happens in your system, or there's a downtime that can possibly happen, the resilience of the system is adjusted if the system can withstand that sort of an outage, or the system stays afloat irrespective of the fault happening. And that is where resiliency comes into play. But what are the examples of resiliency, or what are the examples of weaknesses in a Kubernetes native system? So let's say a pod is evicted from a node, or a node goes to not ready state, or there's a memory leak in a container or in a disk. So if the pod is rescheduled, or if that and the dependent service is healthy, or the node is healthy, or the dependent service in a memory leak situation is still healthy, then the system is resilient. But let's say the dependent service turns out to be slow and turns out to be unhealthy, and the system goes down and you cannot resurrect the system, then of course the system is unhealthy, and that's an example of a weakness. That's how weaknesses were identified in Kubernetes. In spite of being a really resilient infrastructure, the world is dynamic. Every day there are new changes that are happening, and these are the possible weaknesses that can happen in a system. So downtimes are pretty expensive. These are a few examples. I've taken out Apple back in 2015, approximately lost $25 million, and companies over the years have lost $90 million, $150 million. These are just examples from the airline sector, Facebook from the social media platform sector. And then if you have to talk about the recent downtime, Slack went down due to a DNS error, and that the work that was going around stopped, and I'm sure Slack lost $1 million altogether. So these are some examples of downtimes in production that usually stop your operations, and they impact your system. They impact the resiliency of the system and tell you that why resiliency and reliability is so important. Focus on the container level challenges, the Kubernetes native challenges, or the system level challenges that they face due to inadequate testing or the requirement of continuous testing and observability. So what is chaos engineering? This actually brought in the term, or helped coin the term, chaos engineering. Chaos engineering is nothing but deliberately inducing a fault into the system, a weakness into the system, to ensure that it can withstand any unexpected disruptions that happen in the real world, or that happen while the system goes into production. So it's a way in which you induce chaos into your system in a controlled way by inducing chaos tests or random unpredictable behavior in the form of chaos experiments. And then these experiments help you identify when is your system weak and how can you make them resilient, or basically define the your resiliency goals. As an SRE, you can define your SLAs, your SLOs and SLIs, and this basically helps you identify the weaknesses and the resiliency points of your system. So why exactly is chaos engineering required? I mean, we are talking about chaos here. A few of you might be already aware of this term. A few of you are still finding out or figuring out what chaos is. So here is an example of an application or a Kubernetes application. So as you can see, I mean, there is your application which is up there. It's in form of a pyramid. And the application that you're using is the top of the pyramid. Okay, that's your application. But then there are other services, your cloud native services, Kubernetes native services, platform services, which is the infrastructure layer, that is also present alongside making up your infrastructure or making up your system. So, I mean, you can usually people, you know, end up doing penetration testing, performance testing, integration testing, all these forms of testing to your application. But with all these layers, I mean, resiliency depends upon each and every layer. So each and every layer needs to be tested, or each and every cloud native component needs to be tested repeatedly. And that is why chaos engineering is required, because it helps you test each and every layer continuously. Until and this, you can define your resiliency goals. So, I mean, too many applications, as I said, can affect the resiliency of your service. The day the world is dynamic, every other day you're having more and more applications coming up. There is a new enhancement that comes up in your system, and these applications are changing themselves very often. So the need of constantly validating the resiliency of your entire system comes into place, and that is why chaos engineering is essential. So how does, I mean, we are talking about DevOps here. So where does chaos engineering lie? I mean, there are dev tests, unit tests, integration tests, as I talk about. They are on the dev side of the DevOps loop. I mean, they are just more, I mean, the developer persona is more attracted to that. And these kind of tests lie on that side of things. But chaos testing focuses more on the ops side of things, where you're deploying and then you're monitoring them. Observability is key. You observe where your systems are going down, what exactly is happening to your system. And that is why chaos, I mean, the feedback loop or the DevOps loop can be activated through proactive testing, repeated testing. And the belief is, or the litmus chaos community believes in testing, proactive testing in production, and the chaos first principle. Basically, why to wait for your systems to go down? Why not test your systems initially itself, so that you can, you know, I mean, chaos engineering is also called breaking things on purpose. I mean, if you might have heard. But we believe that chaos engineering is not just breaking things on purpose, it's breaking things on purpose to mitigate your systems, to identify your weaknesses and make them resilient. So that is why test, do not wait. So what are the four simple steps? I mean, before I move on to the four simple steps, I would like to take you to another part of chaos engineering, that is the principles of chaos engineering. This is a document, I'll share the link by the end of this talk, which talks about what chaos engineering is, and it takes you through how chaos engineering is practiced. So the first step is identifying the steady state of your system. As you can see, it's the steady state. So what exactly steady state is? How your system behaves when it is normal, how the system is when there are no faults that are induced in the system, and how the system might behave if there's a weakness or if there's a fault that happens in a system. That helps you identify the steady state, and you hypothesize around it. You build a hypothesis that you focus on the measurable output rather than any other attributes, and then you know, measure that output over a short period of time. So I mean, as you build a hypothesis, what is important is you vary your real world events. So the real world events are the faults that can happen on any day. I mean, there can be malfunctions, there can be software failures, there can be hardware failures, or even non-failure events like spike in traffic. So before I move ahead, I would like to take an example. How did chaos engineering come into place, or what was the exact idea behind it? So when chaos engineering came into play, it was brought in by Netflix through Chaos Monkey. And back in 2012, it's almost been 9 years now. So the idea was to understand how they can mitigate the spike in traffic. Netflix wanted to, I mean, cater to software failures, of course, but the spike scaling was very important for them. and that is why they brought in Chaos Monkey to just bringing network testing and testing in production and understanding how they can mitigate this and how this sort of failure can be identified. And since then it has changed so much that Netflix brought in Chaos Monkey, and then came in so many players from Netflix itself to, I mean, closed source projects or enterprise level projects like Gremlin or Verica or Steadybit. And then in the CNCF paradigm came in so many projects where the idea was to, I mean, open source is the future, open source is the present and key. So the idea was to adopt open source projects and bring in the cloud native way of doing it. So once you have varied, coming back, once you have varied your real world events, you run your experiments in production. I mean, for example, in a Kubernetes paradigm, you run a pod delete or a pod CPU hog or a pod memory hog. These are examples. We'll move on to many more chaos experiments when we introduce litmus. But this is how, you know, you understand the behavior of your system, and it depends upon your environment and traffic patterns, of course. I mean, that is how your systems behave to each and every experiment. And Chaos strongly prefers to experiment directly on production traffic. I mean, you can experiment anywhere. As I mentioned, you can experiment in staging, you can experiment in your pre-staging environment, in your pre-prod environment. But Chaos is meant for eventually going on into production. And then you automate your experiments. I mean, manually, you don't want to run them. You don't want to keep on running. I mean, running experiments is obviously labor intensive, but the idea of Chaos engineering is automating them and continuously building that resilience into your system to both drive both orchestration and analysis. And lastly, I mean, obviously Chaos engineering. So yeah, minimizing your blast radius. That's the last part of it. I mean, running experiments in production has the potential to cause unnecessary pain. I mean, there can be a negative impact to it as well. So I mean, Chaos engineering is a powerful practice, and the culture today is that everyone is not adopting Chaos. I mean, the shift is there, but it hasn't crossed the adoption chasm yet, or it hasn't crossed the majority adoption chasm, because there are various reasons. A few people are not ready with it yet, or there's no budget in place, it's not a part of the roadmap, or the systems are not ready for it. So the easiest way to do it is follow these principles, follow the principles of Chaos, and eventually run your Chaos in a very safe way and a structured way. So that is how Chaos engineering is practiced in four simple ways. As I mentioned, you identify the steady state, you hypothesize around it, you experiment, and you adapt. Your system adapts, you adapt, and this comes in as a culture rather than just a technology. So how does that build the resilience? I mean, these are the steps we talked about: identifying the steady state, introducing a fault. If the steady state conditions are regained, then yes, your systems are resilient, but they are resilient for that particular experiment. So then you inject a new fault and this loop continues. But let's say there's a weakness found, your system is not up to the mark, and then obviously you fix and you introduce a fault, and that is how this flow continues, or that is how you keep on injecting a fault and running Chaos in your system. So how is it typically done? How is Chaos engineering practiced? I mean, we have got game days, of course. A Chaos engineering game day is nothing but, I mean, running Chaos in a structured way through your specific applications, or a demo application where you run certain Chaos experiments which are applicable to your use case or your understanding. And then you formulate your findings, you formulate what exactly is the output of running Chaos in the system, why is it necessary, how can you observe them, what are the events that were created, and you track them, you bring in some metrics to understand, and you can end up creating a white paper or a working paper alongside, so that the game day basically helps you bring in the Chaos engineering practice or understand the vulnerabilities that are present in your system. But as of now, it's still rarely integrated into the CI/CD, whereas the personal belief is Chaos needs to be brought into the CI/CD of the system. As a DevOps practitioner, you need to test your CI/CD as well. But as of now, the practice is still not there. Being part of the community, I mean, the developer persona has started shifting into the Chaos practice, or Chaos engineering is being used by the developer persona lately. But as of now, still the SREs are typically practicing Chaos, or the site reliability goals include practicing Chaos engineering. So that's the current scenario of it. Manual planning and execution is there, but the goal obviously is automating them, automating the overall test suite, automating the chaos. But slowly, slowly with manual planning, that is being moved to. Observability, as I talked about, is not a commodity. It's key. You need to understand, you need to see where your systems are going down, where exactly the chaos is being induced. And obviously there needs to be a custom measurement process to manage all these things, which is still not in place, but slowly, slowly with results and with the increase in the reliability goals, this is coming up. So what exactly is Litmus? Litmus is a framework, it's a tool set which helps you induce chaos. It's a CICF sandbox project, and it's a tool set which is, I mean, found to test an application meant for cloud native data. And it, initially the mission was for Kubernetes SREs and developers to find weaknesses both in their non-Kubernetes as well as Kubernetes running platforms. But now it's moving on to a cross-cloud platform, and there are non-Kubernetes scenarios which are coming up. So Litmus Chaos is the CNCF project which helps you induce chaos in a controlled way, and then you obviously have the suite of getting them from a marketplace called the Chaos Hub. So these are the project stats. I mean, 50 plus chaos experiments, approximately 500,000 experiment runs, and 200,000 plus installations. I mean, the GitHub repo and Slack link, obviously, I'll be sharing. But the project is growing, and the project is growing in a grand way. So as you can see, I mean, this is the main page. You can find it out here, open source chaos engineering platform, and how does it help you. These are some resources, and this is the architectural diagram. I mean, we'll move to that later on, but a lot of folks have adopted the same. The adoption level is high, and there are a lot of features which help you induce chaos in a very controlled way, and it's open source, so you can contribute to the community as well, and that helps the project develop. So moving on, we'll talk about the Chaos Hub first. When we talked about having Kubernetes native experiments, the Chaos Hub is the marketplace which helps you take up these experiments, or which helps you utilize these chaos experiments that are readily available for you to induce chaos. So there are experiments on Kubernetes, generic Kubernetes based, Cassandra, application specific Cassandra, Kafka based, Core DNS based experiments, then AWS based experiments, VMware, GCP, Azure. All these experiments are already present, so you can just pull in your experiment, you can bring up the portal, and you can pull in any experiment from the Chaos Hub and start running these experiments easily and induce chaos in a controlled way. Other than this, you are also, I mean, where in DevOps you can use, as I mentioned, you can in the DevOps loop, you can use Litmus, or you can induce chaos anywhere. So you can use them in your DevCI pipelines. You can have long running tests going on. You can have them in your staging or pre-staging environment, as we call, in your pre-prod or your production environment. So, I mean, It's pretty easy for you, Litmus. It's a two-step process. Either you can use a Helm chart to pull in, or you can just, pull in the YAML file and you can start experimenting. You just need a Minikube or any Kubernetes cluster running, and then it becomes very easy for you to just start inducing chaos in a controlled way. So what has the journey of Litmus been, or how did it start? It started back in 2017-18 to test OpenEBS, another CNCF project for cloud native data management. The hub was created, the marketplace, it was made open source, and some custom resources were created, just like the operator, the scheduler. The operator helps you run the chaos experiments. With the scheduler, you can schedule your experiments. So when do you want to run a particular experiment? For how long do you want that experiment to run? When do you want it to stop? So all this is ensured by the scheduler. And obviously, an individual was able to inject chaos in a very controlled way, or a single experiment was induced initially, and it did not have a UI. So the visualization part, or still there was a lot to achieve on the monitoring side. But with 2.0, which came up last month, it's just been one and a half months since 2.0 came out, it already possesses all the features of 1.x, But then there were additional chaos workflows. A workflow is nothing but multiple chaos experiments or a chaos engineering test suite. Let's say you want to run a pod network and a pod latency and then a pod delete experiment together. So that comes in form of a workflow. So we integrated with Orgo. I think a lot of people know about Orgo CD already. So Orgo workflows were created in, Litmus Chaos and Orgo formed chaos workflows. And these workflows helped organizations create a test suite, and it was not just meant for a single user but rather a team. So I mean, as a team or as an enterprise, there are people who want to use it as a, you know, not just individually but various multiple team members want to induce chaos into various systems in different ways. So that was very important to manage completely, to visualize what is happening. So a chaos center was introduced, which is the UI or the basic central management system or center where you can basically run your chaos experiments, visualize them, you can schedule them, you can bring or pull in experiments from the chaos hub, or you can create your own chaos hub. So Litmus helps you with an SDK where you can write your own experiments. Let's say, I mean, there are 50 experiments in the hub, but you want chaos, you want to induce chaos in your Jenkins pipeline, or you are having JMeter where you want to induce chaos, or you are having a Redis based applications where you want to induce chaos. So that is something you can write by yourself through the Litmus SDK, which is available in Go, Python and Ansible. And then you can induce them using the Litmus platform itself into your systems. And monitoring and observability, as we talked about it, monitoring is key. Observability, you pull in the metrics in the form of Prometheus metrics, and through your Grafana dashboards, you can visualize them, or you can visualize them in the Chaos Center itself, which provides with an inbuilt visualizing tool set. And then you calculate the resiliency score, how resilient is your system, did the experiments pass or not. There are health checks that are available in form of probes, so HTTP probe, Prometheus probe. All these probes help you. They are in form of custom health checks, which help you define the health of your system or how resilient your system are. And then scaling is important. We talked about GitOps. I mean, GitOps is the future. GitOps is the present and the future as well. So there was a GitOps integration, which helps you scale your system. So what are the advantages? I mean, as you can see, the advantages are that there's a chaos center, which acts as a UI. There are additions of chaos agent, which help you run experiments easily. There were new experiments that were added, AWS, Azure, and VMware, where the focus of the community was that Kubernetes is one part of it, but we are yet to adopt Kubernetes completely. I mean, as individuals or enterprises, the Kubernetes shift is still ongoing and people are still using legacy systems. The microservices architectures have a lot of AWS based systems, Azure based systems. So that is where the need of the hour was to expand the test suite and have these experiments. Bring your own chaos. As I mentioned, the SDK helps you bring your own chaos. The workflows are managed using GitOps, and multi-tenancy, obviously, I mean, that these are the enhancements of the features which one looks forward to. And over the time of monthly cadences or every month, there's a community meeting that is happening on the third Wednesday. The community output, there are various various sectors, the e-commerce, the banking, the fintech. These sectors have various use cases which help the community developer, which help a project understand what are the advantages or what is required in a chaos engineering tool set. So these are the core components I could have covered one by one. What's the chaos center, where you can obviously manage your systems. A chaos engine agent is nothing but the target cluster where chaos is injected. And there are so many announcements which we can be talking about, but I would rather be talking about what is the future roadmap for this, what is the future of chaos, and how you can contribute to it before concluding. So I mean, for the future roadmap, the idea is to have more non-Kubernetes native experiments and increase the support for it, for the infrastructure components and for your physical systems as well. The idea is that more physical infrastructures or monolithic architectures are also requiring chaos checks. So the idea is to bring in that and more application specific chaos. I mean, there's Cassandra, Kafka, and Core DNS, but the idea is to expand this test suite. So the suggestions are welcome, obviously, which applications require such specific experiments and how that can be validated. And then improved Chaos SDK, the idea is that more and more folks can write their own Chaos experiments and bring in them to the Chaos Hub. So the creation of user-defined experiments are very important. And obviously improving the observability, adding more probes to diversify the steady state hypothesis validation and custom health checks is part of the future roadmap. And you can contribute to it because it's CNCF native, it's an open source project. So every contribution is welcome. A good first issue is something that can be picked up. I think Oktoberfest has also started, so there are a few issues related to that. If you want, you can go ahead and check them. And I mean, it can be bug fixes, enhancements, documentation, bug or feature reports, anything. And you can choose the sub-dependent repos to contribute to. These are the few highlighted repos, the charts, the workflows, the test tools, Litmus Go, and website, obviously. And you can start contributing. So join the Slack community. That's part of the Kubernetes Slack, Litmus channel on the Kubernetes Slack. You can join that and you can reach out to the maintainers or the core contributors, and hopefully soon you can also become one of the core contributors. So here is the code available, github.com litmus chaos litmus. The docs are there and Slack, as I mentioned. So with this, thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed the talk, and feel free to check out Litmus today and the documentation specifically. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them.